This is CNN Breaking News.
Hello, I'm Brianna Keeler, and I want to welcome viewers here in the United States and around the world. We continue with the breaking news. 48 hours after the election was called for Joe Biden, President Trump has just fired his defense secretary. I want to go to CNN's Caitlin Collins at the White House. Caitlin, can you give us the latest on this?
Yeah, Brianna, the president just let us know by Twitter that he has terminated Mark Esper and is instead going to put an acting defense secretary in his place. That's the director of the National Counterterrorism Center that's going to be serving in that position. And this is a role that Esper likely would have only had for about two more months. But it was clear that the president had been wanting to fire Esper for some time. And Brianna, he came incredibly close over the summer to doing it and had to have some interventions from Esper allies to convince the president not to fire the defense secretary while he was campaigning to be reelected. And so they had assured the president he could wait until after the election and then he would have this chance. And now the president has taken it. And it's notable that it actually took this long for the president to do so. Of course, he's been a little preoccupied over the last few days with trying to contest the outcome of the election. But the president and his defense secretary had a relationship that completely deteriorated since about May. They had been on terrible footing to where the president was furious with Esper on so many occasions. He at one point at a press conference, remember, referred to him as Yesper, saying that he was a yes man who said yes to everything. And it was just very clear that the writing was on the wall, that Mark Esper did not have long to go. And last week, our colleagues at the Pentagon reported that Esper had actually prepared a resignation letter in case he needed to turn it in this week because they wanted to make it as smooth of a transition as possible. So he knew this was coming, but instead of letting Esper turn in that resignation letter, it appears the president has just flat out terminated him. And we'll have to wait to get details because remember, the last time the president fired a defense secretary with Mattis when he resigned in protest, the president and his aides tried to frame it as a retirement was happening when actually we found out shortly thereafter that Mattis was resigning in protest over the president's decisions when it came to troop withdrawals. So we'll have to wait to see what are the details here with Esper and how exactly this went down. But the other thing is, he might just be the first one that's on the chopping block because we know the president has been very unhappy with the Attorney General Bill Barr because he didn't feel like he prosecuted enough of his political opponents or prosecuted any of his political opponents to the degree that the president wanted. But also the FBI director, Chris Wray, who typically would serve a 10-year term, the president has also wanted to fire him as well. So really what the president is saying with this tweet firing Esper is that this is not going to be a quiet transition that you've seen with past presidents. They're in this lame duck period and someone else is replacing them. It can often be a pretty sleepy period. Donald Trump, it clearly is not going to be, Brianna.
No, clearly not. Caitlin, thank you so much. I want to go over to Barbara Starr at the Pentagon. And, you know, to that point, Barbara, this is supposed to be about transition. Normally, at this point in time, it's about moving things as smoothly as possible. You know, especially we're talking about a change in party here. And that is not what this is doing. Tell us about what the effect of firing Mark Esper, what is the effect going to be on the country on national security?
Well, look, there's no way around it. To some large extent, it throws the system into turmoil at the moment, because this really is, at least right this minute, a shockwave through the Pentagon. Everybody knew Esper was on the outs with the president, but there was a sense, if you will, that he could make it through to the end of the administration. I mean, just a minute ago, I was out in the hallway. I stopped the first military officer that I saw in the hallway that I knew. I asked him, have you heard? He said, what? You know, they didn't even know. And so I gave him the news, and his response, not suitable for the airwaves, because it was that much of a surprise. So where are we right now? Esper will go. We will find out exactly how all of this transpired. But there are a number of things at the Pentagon right now that are exceptionally critical. You still have troops in Afghanistan. The president says he wants them home by Christmas. Military commanders have told the president that's too optimistic. There's still a high level of violence U.S. troops need to stay in Afghanistan. Will that be a decision, a recommendation from commanders in the field that the president lets stand? The same thing about troops in Syria, troops in Iraq, and a number of special forces arrayed across Africa. What will happen with the troops? Is the president simply going to issue some edict? He wants everybody to come home. That would throw things into significant disarray because the U.S. military wants to have an enduring presence overseas, extend U.S. influence with allies, and keep a sharp watch on adversaries. So this will be an issue. Mark Esper was actually scheduled to travel to Europe next week to talk about troop withdrawals from Germany and a revised U.S. military presence in Europe. Don't know if that will now happen with the new acting Secretary of Defense. May not, and that will be an issue because the president wants a troop reduction in Germany. U.S. commanders have a very mixed view on that. When the Congress comes back in and really gets to work on the defense spending bill, one of the first things on the agenda, and Mr. Trump may be headed for a significant loss here, will be that legislation part of the spending bill to rename military bases that are currently named after Confederate generals. Congress, with bipartisan support, wants to rename those bases. The president does not. He may be headed, by all accounts, for a significant loss on that in December. There's just no way around it. It throws everything into a bit of turmoil. Not to say that the new acting secretary is not a perfectly competent person, doesn't know the issues, can't get involved very quickly, but it throws things into turmoil. And once again, potentially, you know, left on the hot seat here is the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Mark Milley. He is the president's chief military advisor. He is broadly seen as someone who tries to deal with Trump, who tries to find a way to convince the president to do the right thing on military decisions. Some people say he's an ally of Trump. Most people say he's nonpartisan as the chairman of the Joint Chiefs. But Milley's the guy left behind. Milley is now the guy that the president ultimately will turn to for military advice. And will he be able to convince the president, you know, not to have a period of turmoil for in national security for the 70-plus odd days ahead of us until inauguration? Brianna?
Yeah, it's hard to imagine, I want to bring Caitlin back into this, for someone like Mark Milley to look at a decision like this and say, oh, that is the right thing for the country that I am sworn to protect. And Caitlin, one of the things you mentioned was this might not just be a one-off thing, that there are other folks who are on the chopping block here. So, you know, what's going on here? The president clearly at this point in time, and I'm sure he should be aware of this. At this point in time in a lame duck presidency, this is where the lame duck president sort of fades into the background. Their power is certainly diminished at this point in time. And eyes start to focus on the transition of the new administration coming in. It seems like the president, with his kind of typical attention-seeking behavior, is having a really difficult time with that.
Yeah, Donald Trump does not like to not be in the headlines. That's something that aides have said he's going to struggle with since it has been declared that Joe Biden is the winner. But also, Brianna, he doesn't like not being in charge and not feeling like things are within his control, because this is a president who thinks he can will things into happening. And we've seen that take place even with the election. He was surprised and astonished that Joe Biden could potentially beat him. He kept talking to aides about that, saying, could this person really beat me? And could I really be down with suburban women voters? Something that he talked about at rallies. And so the president tried to will himself into being reelected, even though the writing had been on the wall for months that his poll numbers had been dropping. And so this is something he can control. He can control who's in his cabinet. And Mark Esper was at the top of the list. So is the FBI director. So is the attorney general, who I should note, we have not laid eyes on Bill Barr in quite some time. No one really knows what the attorney general has been up to, and the FBI director has also been keeping his head down in recent days. So that's the question. Is the president going to continue this purge, to this revenge purge, basically, to get back at people who he didn't like what they've been doing for the last several months? And he would have fired them much earlier if he had not been up for reelection. And he was basically told by aides, if you fire these people, it's going to be bad for you. It's going to affect your reelection chances. And the president didn't get reelected anyway, so now I think he is taking his anger out on people like Mark Esper, who knew that this was coming likely, but as Barbara noted, still the fact that it happened today was a bit of a surprise. So the question is, why Esper now, and who is next?